وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد إن شاء الله تعالى today we're going to be doing the following verses قال تبارك وتعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تأكلوا أموالكم بينكم بالباطل إلا أن تكون تجارة عن تراض منكم ولا تقتلوا أنفسكم إن الله كان بكم رحيما ومن يفعل ذلك عدوانا وظلما فسوف نصليه نارا وكان ذلك على الله يسيرا إن تجتنبوا كبائر ما تنهون عنه نكفر عنكم سيئاتكم وندخلكم مدخلا كريما This verse, I mean these verses, Allah تبارك وتعالى, He is prohibiting the believers from taking wealth from one another unjustly. Allah is تبارك وتعالى, He is saying, those of you who believe, who have tasted the sweetness of al-Iman, don't take one another's wealth in ways which are haram. And from the ways that people can take wealth from one another in a haram manner is by stealing, for example, or gambling, or riba, usury. All of those are ways where you take the wealth of someone in a unjust way, or a prohibited way in the Sharia. So what is it that we do? We take the money from one another in a way that is pleasing to both parties. At-tariq, tariq al-tijara, trading, buying. Because Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, the way that He created mankind is, we require something that may be in the possession of someone else. I might need a product, that person owns the product, it's his. So, but he needs the wealth in my possession. So the Sharia, what does it do? You give him this and he gives you this. That's called tijara, trading, business, which is built upon what? Taradin. It's built on both parties are pleased. Al-mutabayi'ayni, both parties who are buying are happy. One is buying the wealth or he's taking the wealth and the other one is taking the product. And that's halal, as the Sharia يعني, states and points out. And what is permissible in taking from someone, or in other words, the methods in which you can take product from people, the methods which are permissible are far more than the methods which are haram. But the shaitan whispers to the person to go and take that wealth from the person in a haram way. Then the ayah, or the ayat that I read, it mentions don't kill one another. Don't take the life of someone else. And inshallah ta'ala, I will mention the relationship between don't take wealth from each other in a haram way and don't kill one another, the relationship between it. And the reason why Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He connected the two, as I will mention inshallah ta'ala in the episode. And then Allah concluded the verse by mentioning that He subhanahu wa ta'ala is very merciful to His creation. And then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in the verse after that, He made a warning. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, that those who take the wealth of the people بالباطل in falsehood, and that he goes and he kills, either kills other people or he kills himself, that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is going to deal with that person severely. And that that person has exceeded his boundaries that were set for him. And that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is going to burn that person in the hellfire and he's going to place it in him. Yeah, and I was going to place him in that hellfire, and that this is not something very hard on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He addresses the ibad, the slaves, He addresses them subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He informs them to stay away from falling into sins, the major sins. He tells them to stay away from it subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so that's the overall meaning of what is in those verses. And finally He says subhanahu wa ta'ala, that if you stay away from the major sins, and if you stay away from being consistent upon the minor sins, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will place you into Jannah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and what a good place to be. So let's break those verses down. I've given you the overall meaning in it. Let's now break it down. First verse, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, those of you who believe, who've tasted Iman, who believe in Allah, who believe in the Day of Judgment, who have Iman. And we all know the famous statement of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, where he said, إِذَا سَمِعْتَ اللَّهَ يَقُولُ, if you hear Allah tabarak wa ta'ala saying, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, if you hear it, فَأَرْعِهَا سَمْعَكَ, bring your ear close. If you hear يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, straight away listen, be attentive, something's going to be said. He said it's one of two things. Either you're going to be commanded to do something, or you're going to be prohibited from something. Whenever you see يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, right after it, what you're going to see is either a command or a prohibition. So you're being addressed, inshallah ta'ala, as a mu'min. So you should try to, or you should listen attentively. So Allah says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, those of you who believe. So then is it a command or is it a prohibition that came after? It's a prohibition. La ta'kulu amwalakum. Do not eat one another's wealth. Bil batili, in falsehood. What does that mean? It means the way that you try to take someone's wealth should not be batil. Illa an takuna tijaratan. It has to be, or it should be. So look at this. This is one of the masail, or one of the points that the ulama took from here. That the mustathna, the istithna, doesn't have to be from the mustathna minhu. It doesn't have to be from the same jins. In usul al-fiqh, there's something that scholars talk about, which is, if a person wants to do an exception, does the thing that you're going to do the exception from have to be the same as the thing that you're doing the exception for? What does that mean? For example, you say, Ja' al-qawmu, the people came. Illa Zayd, except Zayd. Okay, pay attention. The people came except Zayd. Zayd is from the people, that makes sense. That's from the, because they're people. And Zayd is a person, he's from the people. They're all the same jinns, they're from the same, huh? They are from the same essence. But are you allowed to say, Ja' al-qawmu, the people came, illa al-khimar, except the donkey? Some scholars, they said you can't say that. It's not allowed for you to say that, because the donkey can't be an exception from al-qawm, because al-qawm is humans, people, and the donkey is not part of them. So why would you make an exception from it? Some scholars, they said it is allowed, and that's a discussion we've tackled and we've spoken about in other places. But the scholars who say that you can, this is the evidence that they use, which is Allah said, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, those of you who believe, la ta'kulu amwalakum, do not take one another's wealth, baynakum bil batili, in falsehood. And then after that, he said, illa an takuna tijaratan. Unless it's what? It's a tijara. The scholars, they said, tijara was never ever taking the wealth of someone by falsehood. So why would there be an exception, aslan? And of course, those who have the other opinion, they still argue that this ayah is not strong in this regard. But that's not what we want to speak about here, okay? Allah says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, those of you who believe, la ta'kulu amwalakum, do not eat one another's wealth, or take one another's wealth, baynakum, between yourselves, bil batili, in falsehood, illa an takuna tijara, unless it's by way of tijara. That tijara is an taradhim minkum, it's you're pleased with one another's trading in this issue. And then Allah says, wala taqtulu anfusakum, do not kill your nafs, don't kill one another. Inna Allah kana bikum rahima, verily Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is one that is very merciful to you. What's the relationship with this verse before, with the previous verse before it? The ayat before it, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala was talking about the nikah, and he was talking about how to deal with the concept of nikah and etc. And now Allah is moving on to the concept of wealth. The reason is because wealth is the means to marriage. And every ayah has a relationship with the ayah before it and the ayah after it. The Qur'an is connected. The way, the path to marriage is by money. In other words, if you want to get married, you would have to have money. And so a lot of people, they get married and then they what? And a lot of people, they want to get married, but they don't have the means to get married. So what do? They get the money from a haram means. The Sharia is talking to you on this issue. That's why a lot of the times, majority of the scholars, when they write in issues of fiqh, they start with al-buyu' and then they speak about al-nikah. And there are some scholars who speak about al-nikah and then they speak about buyu' and they follow the order of these verses. Al-buyu' means buying and selling. Once you make money, then you get married. And the categorizations of books of fiqh are based on that. The first one is al-ibadat, your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then there comes the second chapter, which is al-buyu', buying and selling. And then in books of fiqh, the third chapter is al-nikah, marriage, divorce, and issues like that are spoken about. And then there's the chapters of al-jinayat, crimes that people commit. Because when people make money, and then they get married, a lot of the time people transgress. They've got comfortable life, so they go to the jinayat, crimes that they commit. So there's a chapter for them. And then right at the ending is the chapter of al-hudud, capital punishments, where consequences of those crimes that the people have committed. So here, it's in that order, in the sense where marriage was spoken about, but what is the means to marriage? It is through wealth. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He talks about it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, those of you who believe. Allah is talking to the mu'mineen. Do not take, لا تأكلوا here means, أي لا يأخذ بعضكم أموال بعض. Do not take one another's wealth بغير حق, without a lawful way. Now, this is important to say, لا تأكلوا أموالكم بينكم بالباطل. Because sometimes a person's wealth, and some people explain it to say, don't forcefully take people's wealths. That's not a right tafsir of the ayah. Because sometimes in the Sharia, the qadi will be forced to take someone's wealth forcefully in order to provide for his wife. Or even the wife is allowed to take some money from her husband if he's stingy and he's not giving to her. He doesn't want to provide for her. He doesn't give her anything whatsoever. For her to put her hand in his pocket just to get food for herself and her kids, the Prophet permitted it for Hinda. When she complained to him, she said, Ya Rasulullah, Abu Sufyan, he doesn't provide for me. He doesn't give me anything. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, خُذِي مَا يَكْفِيكِ أَنْتَ وَأَنْتِ وَوَلَدُكِ. Take what is enough for you and your child. So this is not her taking the wealth by batil. She took her hamal, or she took her rights, بِحَقٍ, with rights. Okay? What this means is, لَا تَأْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ بِالْبَاطِلِ. It means, أي مِنْ وَسَائِلِ الْكَسْبِ الْمُحَرَّمَةِ. Stay away from the means which are haram, which wealth, so where people take it from, such as al-riba wal-qimar, gambling, and riba, and the likes of these things. And then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says, illa an takuna tijaratan, unless there is a trading, tijara, an taradim minkum, where you're both pleased with one another. You're allowed to. A person's got a product you want, you've got the money, buy it and sell it, buy and sell, no problem. This is permissible. And if both parties are happy with one another, they can. A person can say, I don't want to sell my products. In Islam, he has the right to do so. And so does another person say, I don't want to spend on your product. I don't want to buy your product. Both has to be based on an taradi. Both parties have to be pleased. And then Allah says, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. What's the relationship between لا تأكلوا أموالكم بينكم بالباطل and ولا تقتلوا أنفسكم? Don't kill yourselves. First of all, ولا تقتلوا أنفسكم, there's two understandings that can be taken from it. Don't kill another person who's innocent, or don't even kill yourselves, as in you don't kill yourself. Don't commit suicide. The ayah is prohibiting both. ولا تقتلوا أنفسكم, it can mean you don't kill your own self, and it could also mean do not kill your Muslim brothers and sisters, and also don't kill the non-Muslims who Allah tabarak wa ta'ala prohibited from you to kill. There are non-Muslims which we cannot fight with, those who have covenants and those who have, yani, who are not muharibin. We're not in a state of war with them. Okay? So Allah says, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Don't kill one another. But don't kill yourselves. So what's the relationship between it? The relationship between it is Allah tabarak wa ta'ala just spoke about wealth, okay? And not taking it in a haram way. A lot of the times, disputes and argumentations that come from wealth lead to bloodshed. If it's not done in the right way, people tend to become aggressive. ولذلك ولا when the ayah says يا الذين آمنوا لا تأكل أموالكم بينكم بالباطل, one of the things that people take one another's wealth is gambling. And gambling, what does it do? It brings البغضاء. It brings animosity and hate, as Allah prohibited in the ayah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he says, إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ وَالْأَنصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ رِجْسٌ مِنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ الشَّيْطَانَ أَنْ يُوقِعَ بَيْنَكُمُ الْعَدَاوَةَ وَالْبَغْضَاءَ فِي الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ. Shaytan wants to bring hate and animosity in your hearts to one another. When you gamble, a lot of people, they gamble their wealth, they gamble their cars, they gamble their houses. Some of them, وَلِلْأَسَفِ الشَّدِيدِ, gamble even their wives, everything they've owned. And they walk away. And because they've got nothing left anymore, they come in and they kill people. So when wealth is taken from one another in a way that is haram, this is what happens. It leads to death. It leads to killing one another. That's what it does. So look at what the Sharia, brothers, is. Our religion, it's not as what you're seeing today around the world. Damage control. Let things happen and then we'll solve it later. If you look at Western constitutions and laws, you will really find the problem with it is that they put in place and they allow the means to take place and then they try to stop the consequences later. It just makes no sense. Why are we not stopping the means, the things that will lead to this? Should we not stop it? So it doesn't lead to it? No, let it be. For example, if you look at Western countries, kids are not allowed to be disciplined. They don't really allow you to really discipline your children. Children have been given so much rights, over the top. Islam has already given enough rights to them, but they've given them, as they call it, rights. This is not rights. This is dhulm to the child himself. So the child literally has more power than his parents. But then when you see a young kid, recently I saw on YouTube an incident that took place that broke the hearts of many people around the world. Was it a 13 and a 15-year-old girl who stole a car of a Muslim Pakistani man who had kids, who was an Uber driver? 13 and a 15-year-old girl were trying to rob a man's car in New York, steal his car from him, take his car, and he died from that incident. He died. We've lived in the West. We've seen it. We ask ourselves this question. What is it that led to this? What made this happen? In the Sharia, the religion of Islam, it's not a religion that just allows this. It takes it upon itself to make sure that it protects things like this to never happen. So, disciplining the child, protecting the child from a very young age, showing him the path, giving power and empowering the parents. That's what Islam is about. Here, look at the same thing. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, make sure when you take from one another, make it in a halal way. Why? If we do that, because you're not going to fight and kill one another. Everything, it's connected. The Sharia tells you, don't look at a woman that's not lawful to you. Why? Because it's going to lead to zina. Don't listen to things which are haram, music and etc. What's going to happen? Because those things are going to lead to hypocrisy, or they're going to lead to zina, or they're going to lead to liwab, wahakada. And the list goes on. That's the hikam and the maqasid of the Sharia. Allah says, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, don't kill yourselves. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِكُمْ رَحِيمًا. Allah is very merciful to you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dhahak, Ibn Muzahim and Suddi and other great scholars, they mention that the ayah, when Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, don't kill one another, that the ayat can take both meanings. that it can take the meaning of don't kill your Muslim brother or your innocent individual. Don't kill them. وَمَنْ قَتَلَ نَفْسَهُ بِشَيْءٍ فِي الدُّنْيَا عُذِّبَ بِهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. And the second one is the hadith that I just mentioned. That the Prophet ﷺ speaks about, don't kill yourself. Don't commit suicide. So you're not allowed to kill a person. As Allah mentioned, subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَا تَقْتُلُوا النَّفْسَ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ. Don't kill an innocent person. You're not allowed to. That's one. The second one is that you're not allowed to kill yourself. ولذلك the Prophet said, anyone who kills himself, وَمَنْ قَتَلَ نَفْسَهُ بِشَيْءٍ فِي الدُّنْيَا, whatever way that you kill yourself, عُذِّبَ بِهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, the day of judgment, you're going to be punished with that same thing that you killed yourself. So if you killed yourself with a blade, the day of judgment, you're going to be punished with that blade. If you killed yourself by taking poison, you're going to be punished by it. Hadith Abu Huraira specifically mentions, مَنْ قَتَلَ نَفْسَهُ بِحَدِيدَةٍ, anyone who kills himself with a blade, فَحَدِيدَتُهُ فِي يَدِهِ, the person will be placed, the blade will be placed in your hand يوم القيامة, and guess what? يَتَجَوَّأُ بِهَا فِي بَطِّهِ فِي نَارِ جَهَنَّمْ. It's going to be your punishment in the hellfire. And you're going to stay in the hellfire forever, as the hadith mentions, خَالِدًا مُقَلَّدًا فِيهَا أَبَدًا. You're going to stay in the hellfire forever. The hadith even says, وَمَنْ شَرِبَ سُمَّنْ, anyone who drinks poison, فَقَتَلَ نَفْسَهُ, and he kills himself because of the poison that he takes, then he's going to be punishing himself يوم القيامة with that poison that he took. And he's going to stay there forever. If you killed yourself with a rope, and that's you strangled yourself to death, then you're going to be punishing yourself يوم القيامة with that rope that you took, and you're going to stay in hellfire forever. So brothers and sisters, you're not allowed to kill innocent people, and you're not also allowed to kill yourself. Okay? Again, why? Another benefit you can take from it is, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, is if we take the interpretation here means oneself, because we explained what's the relationship between يَا الَّذِينَ عَمَلُوا لَا تَأْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ بِالْبَاطِلِ, and وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا النَّفْسَ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ. If we take that interpretation, which is don't kill one another, the relationship between it. But the question here is if we say وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, that it means don't kill yourselves. What's the relationship between يَا الَّذِينَ عَمَلُوا لَا تَأْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ? The relationship is some people, when they go into financial debt and they're not able to provide for themselves, and what they tend to do is they tend to go out there, try to make wealth in a haram way. They might kill other people. And some people, what they do is they commit suicide. They commit suicide. They don't want to live anymore. They want to leave the dunya. And they commit suicide because of what? Financial issues. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala spoke to us already. He said to us, إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِكُمْ رَحِيمًا. Allah is merciful on His creation. ذُو الرَّحْمَةِ. Allah has mercy upon His creation. However much you believe what you're going through is very hard and tough, just remember Allah is merciful to you than you are to yourself. After that, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says, وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ, anyone who does that, does what? Either kills himself or kills the people around him, or he takes wealth in a haram way. Anyone who does that, وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ, anyone who takes أَمْوَالَ النَّاسِ بِالْبَاطِلِ, takes the people's wealth in a false manner, or he kills himself, or he kills others, وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ عُدْوَانًا وَظُلْمًا, he does it out of, with the qasad, in the intent of what? Of transgression and oppression. This shows us, brothers and sisters, if it happens that you did not know that a type of business transaction that you were doing is haram, okay, you didn't know, you're unaware of it, in the Sharia, of course, you're not going to be sinning for it. Jahl is an excuse. But that is with the condition, brothers and sisters, that you try your best to educate yourself prior to doing this transaction. If you're a businessman, you've got two options. Either you have to go and study Ahkam al-Buyu' and learn al-Buyu' al-Manhiyu anha shara'an. What are the type of transactions and the business trading that are not allowed? You have to study it. Or you could get someone who's learned and studied and grounded and get that person to place him on your advisory board where you take the fatwa from them. It's sad because, walil asaf al-shadid, one of the things I remember hearing from one of my shuyukhs is that a lot of people have businesses and on their advisory board are professional consultants they have who sit with them and tell them, yes, take this wealth, invest it into this business. It's, yep, I've looked at it. I've checked everything for you. I've looked at their history. I've looked at their turnover. I've looked at the revenue that they've made. They've never filed for bankruptcy ever before. And it gives you the whole legit and gives you statistics and breaks their net growth, net profit and their gross profit and wahakada. And then based on that, you invest your wealth in there. Why is it that many people don't have ulama, people of knowledge, who are grounded in the sharia, who know Islamic finance, who sit on that board, who also tell you that this is haram, this is halal, this is haram. Why don't they have it? Many people don't have it. So that's important to have. Someone who looks into it for you. And the person who generally looks into it, because I've come across a lot of situations where a lot of people who sit on that board have to be people who fear Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And the way that a lot of them get caught up in this is that the person will say to you, look, find me a loophole or fatwa, I'll give you a percentage of the profit that we make. And then the person, instead of looking at it from a shari'i perspective, he thinks that, or he believes that if I say halal, they invest, they get money from it. I've got a basic salary, which I'm already getting, alhamdulillah. I'm also going to get percentage from what they make. I'm probably going to be a shareholder and they're going to put me in. That person should remember Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, that you can fall under the يَا يُلَذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَأْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ بِالْبَاطِلِ. You're taking money and wealth which is haram. Then Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he said, فَسَوْفَ نُصْلِيهِ نَارًا. The word نُصْلِيهِ, it means نُدْخِلُهُ. We'll place him and put him inside نَارًا, a hellfire. Here نَارًا here means a severe hellfire, one that will burn him and destroy him. Allah will place him in there. وَكَانَ ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يَسِيرًا. That is an أَمْرٌ سَهْلٌ عَلَى اللَّهِ تَبَارَكُ وَتَعَالَى. It's something that's very easy for Allah تَبَارَكُ وَتَعَالَى. It's not hard for the person who deserves it. For the person who committed those crimes, who killed an innocent person or committed suicide or even took people's wealth unjustly, remember that وَكَانَ ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يَسِيرًا. Punishing you in that for hellfire is a matter which is easy to Allah تَبَارَكُ وَتَعَالَى. Finally, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he says, إِن تَجْتَنِبُوا كَبَائِرَ مَا تُنْهَوْنَ عَنْهُ نُكَفِّرْ عَنْكُمْ سَيِّئَاتِكُمْ وَنُدْخِلْكُمْ مُدْخَلًا كَرِيمًا. This is the ayah that the scholars use to say that the sins, some of it are major sins. And some scholars, they say, there's no such thing as major and minor sins. لَا تَنْظُرْ إِلَىٰ الْمَعْصِيَةِ وَلَكِنْ يُنْظُرْ إِلَىٰ مَنْ عَصَيْتَ. Some scholars, that's the verdict they gave. They said, there's no such a thing as a major and a minor sin. All of them are disobedience of Allah. Don't look at the sin, they said. Hey, look at the one you're sinning to. The one you're disobeying. And some scholars, they responded, they said, no, there is. If you look at Nusus al-Wahyain, there are. There are major and minor sins. Okay? And this is one of the ayats that is used, which is, إِن تَجْتَنِبُوا كَبَائِرًا. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala said it. If you stay away from the major sins. The slave, my beloved brothers and sisters, is never in the sharia ever expected to be what? To be perfect. Allah never created you in that way. That's why what you need to stay away from is the major sins and the consistency of the minor sins. And stay away from being consistent upon minor sins and also falling into the major sins. And Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala mentions here al-wa'id, severe punishment. For what? In doing the major sins. In falling into the major sins. Okay, brothers and sisters. And he mentions to stay away from it. إِن تَجْتَنِبُوا كَبَائِرًا. If you stay away from كَبَائِرَ السَّيِّئَاتِ مَا تُنْهَوْنَ عَنْهُ, that which you've been prohibited from. Allah says, نُكَفِّرْ عَنْكُمْ سَيِّئَاتِكُمْ. مَا مَعَنَا نُكَفِّرْ عَنْكُمْ سَيِّئَاتِكُمْ. The word نُكَفِّرْ comes from the word كُفُرْ. And al-kufr, what does it mean in the lughah? It means as-satr wa taghtiyah. It means to conceal and to hide something. Here it means Allah will conceal your sin for you. يعني يتجاوز لكم. Allah تبارك وتعالى will forgive you. لكن what does it mean نكفر عنكم سيئاتكم? Allah will forgive you and He will conceal for you, subhanahu wa ta'ala, the minor sins that you did. So in this ayah, there's the major and the minor both mentioned. And that's where the scholars used it from. The first part of the ayah said, إِن تَجْتَنِبُوا كَبَائِرَ مَا تُنْهَوْنَ عَنْهُ نُكَفِّرْ عَنْكُمْ سَيِّئَاتِكُمْ وَنُدْخِلُكُمْ مُدْخَلًا كَرِيمًا. How is there a major and minor? The person, he stayed away from the major sins, because he said, إِن تَجْتَنِبُوا. If you stay away from the major sins here, نُكَفِّرْ عَنْكُمْ سَيِّئَاتِكُمْ. What is it that Allah is going to expiate for me? What is it Allah is going to conceal or forgive me for if I've already stayed away from the major sins? It's only the minor sins then. So this is the ayah that the scholars used to say there is major and minor sins. Then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, وَنُدْخِلُكُمْ, we will place you into مُدْخَلًا كَرِيمًا. And مُدْخَلًا كَرِيمًا, it means a jannah. That's what it means, مُدْخَلًا كَرِيمًا. It means Jannah. And that's the call of a lot of the Mufassirin. Al-Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen, he says, نُدْخِلُهُمْ فِي مَكَانٍ. We'll place them in a place. Allah is saying, we'll place them in a place. This فِي مَكَانِ دُخُولٍ كَرِيمٍ. A place that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has blessed. A noble place Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala will put the person into. And that is Jannah. Jannah is the best place a person can be in. Because Jannah is what, my brothers and sisters, it is ما لا عين رأت ولا أذن سمعت ولا خطر على قلب بشر. It is a place where eyes have never seen, ears have never really heard of its reality. Whatever you hear, Jannah is always beyond and above that. You don't really know Jannah. ما لا عين رأت ولا أذن سمعت ولا خطر على قلب بشر. And really, nothing like it has come to your heart. All of these beautiful, luxurious places you're seeing, and you're saying, wow, I want to spend an evening there, I enjoy. Jannah is greater and beyond that. It's better and greater than that. I'm going to stop there, inshallah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong and incorrect is from me, shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are both free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdi, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.
Ramadan with AMAU. Make this the best Ramadan you've ever had by joining our exclusive online community with regular private classes, digital resources, weekly accountability sessions, and daily Qur'an gatherings. This is one opportunity you definitely do not want to miss. So sign up now at amau.org/Ramadan, and we look forward to welcoming you on the other side.